Good morning. A very warm welcome to our service from this beautiful part of Dartmoor. My sisters and I grew up in a Baptist chapel which rejoiced in the name of Ebenezer. Ebenezer is a Hebrew word and means, right up to this point, the Lord has helped us. It was used to remind the people of Israel that God had never let them down. He had been there for them through good times and bad. On this second Sunday of Advent, we continue to wait expectantly for the coming of Jesus, both as a baby in Bethlehem and as the glorious King of all creation. And we remember the prophets who kept the hope of rescue alive for the people of God. In particular, we remember the greatest of them all, John the Baptist. In the same way that we look forward to the light of the vaccine in the darkness of the pandemic, we continue to look forward to the light of Emmanuel, God with us. He who has helped us up until now and will be with us to the end. This brings us to our first hymn. On Jordan's bank, the Baptist's cry announces that the Lord is nigh. Now turn back to God and seek his forgiveness for the times we have got things wrong. Let us be still before the Lord. Rest quietly in his presence. Listen. Let us bring before the Lord the words that may have hurt and all those left unsaid, the anger we have felt and resentment we have fed. Let us be still before the Lord. Rest quietly in his presence. Listen. The Lord is slow to anger, willing to forgive, full of grace. Draw near to him. Rest quietly in his presence. Listen.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 to 11, in which God's people are comforted. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill will be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the word Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up. Do not fear. Say to the cities of Jerusalem, here is your God. See, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep. This is the word of the Lord.
The Gospel is taken from Mark chapter 1, starting at the first verse. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, see, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, the one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thongs of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.
John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness. Mark's description is typically stark. There was the wilderness, and suddenly there was John the Baptist doing his thing. Whereabouts in the wilderness, we want to ask, and when exactly? And where did he suddenly appear from? Matthew is equally vague. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, he tells us in chapter 3, verse 1. The writer of the Gospel of John is no more help. And that's a bit disconcerting, isn't it? If we were writing about somebody famous today, we would be much clearer about the details, so there could be no doubt. But this is where Luke comes in, because Luke is very specific. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, And Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Isanias, ruler of Abilene. During the high priesthood of Ananias and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Well, thank goodness for that. We know exactly where, and we know exactly when, and we know exactly who. No room for doubt. To be fair to Mark, although he doesn't give us much information about the wheres and the whens, he does tell us a lot about John himself. He was clothed with camel's hair, we are told, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. Not a figure that would be likely to impress us today, I feel. But of course, a much more important question to ask is, how would his message be received today? How would we feel if someone appeared in Chagford, say, or Morton, dressed rather strangely and asking us to examine ourselves and acknowledge our sins and failures, telling us that we need to repent and prepare ourselves, but not just ourselves, but the whole earth, for the coming of Christ? How would we feel? Feel? Well, I think we would shift uncomfortably in our seats, because it's a bit of a tall order, isn't it? We try our best to spread the good news of God's love, but quite frankly, these are difficult times, and we have a lot on our minds. And let's be honest, there are times when the mountain we have to climb as Christians seems a bit high, and from time to time we have our doubts. We like certainty and specifics and dates and times. And sometimes we have our doubts. Well, take heart. We're not alone. So did John the Baptist. His own particular mountain, as we know, included imprisonment and eventually a rather gory death. But that death was preceded by doubt. John sent two disciples to Jesus when he was in prison to ask him, "Are you the one who is to come?" And Jesus answered by saying, "Tell him what you see. The lame walk, the blind see, the deaf are healed." We don't know, though, whether that message ever got back to John, and if it did, whether he took heart from it, or whether he still had his doubts. He died very suddenly and unexpectedly. It's likely that he went to his death still wondering whether he'd done the right thing in baptizing Jesus, whether he had in fact made any difference at all. He certainly went to his death not knowing the impact his ministry was to have. He baptized Jesus, and as a direct result of that act has come the baptism of every Christian person since. He prepared the way of the Lord, and the rest, as they say, is history. But he went to his death not knowing that. And in the same way, we don't know. We 21st century Christians who are shifting uncomfortably in our seats, we who are trying our best to make straight the way of the Lord, who are trying our best to witness to the good news of God's love to the world. We have our doubts. We are aware of our shortcomings. We sometimes find it tough, and we don't know what good we are doing, or if we're doing any good at all. But John the Baptist's message to us is clear. In the second year of the premiership of Boris Johnson, when Donald Trump is president of the USA, during the papacy of Francis I, when Justin Welby is the Archbishop of Canterbury, a voice is calling in the wilderness of our hearts, asking that we repent and change, and that we then change the world around us, so that Christ can come to his kingdom on earth, and all will see the salvation of God. It might seem like a desert we are calling out in, but we must keep calling. We must keep preparing the way of the Lord, because we are making a difference. Despite our doubts, despite the potholes we fall down, we are making straight paths for Christ. As Isaiah tells us, every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill shall be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together. Amen.
I'm starting today's prayers with a poem by Archbishop Rowan Williams. It's called Advent Calendar, and it echoes the solemnity of the Advent season and shows that it isn't all chocolate and putting up fairy lights. He will come like last leaf's fall, one night when the November wind has flayed the trees to bone and earth wakes choking on the mould, the soft shrouds folding. He will come like frost, one morning when the shrinking earth opens on mist to find itself arrested in the net of alien, sword-set beauty. He will come like dark, one evening when the bursting red December sun draws up the sheet and penny masks its eye to yield the star-snowed fields of sky. He will come. Will come, will come, like crying in the night, like blood, like breaking, as the earth writhes to toss him free. He will come like child. In churches all around the world, special candles are lit each Sunday of Advent. The first is the candle of hope. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. May our hearts be filled with hope as we hear the promises God made to bless all the peoples on earth. Ruler, just and righteous, bring justice to the poor and oppressed. Source of light, remind us again that you burn in our darkness, even here, even now. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The second is the candle of peace and comfort. Intimidated by the glare, let us not hide from your warmth. Bring reconciliation within families, neighbourhoods and cultures, and grant your blessing of peace to the nations. God our Father, your prophets of old spoke of a Saviour who would bring peace. You helped them to spread the joyful message of his coming kingdom. Help us, as we prepare to celebrate his birth, share with those around us the good news of your power and love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The third light is the candle of love shining in the darkness, and is lit to remember John the Baptist. John the Baptist called people to prepare for your coming by caring for one another. Give us willing hearts to reach out to all people in need with your love and compassion. Give reassurance, strength and healing to those who are ill, and consolation to those who mourn. Father of the poor and comforter of the afflicted, we bring to you all those we hold in the silence of our hearts. Protect the souls of all those who have died and those whose anniversaries fall at this time. We pray in the quiet of our minds for any known to us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The fourth light shines as the candle of joy. Often this is a pink candle as opposed to the other purple ones, and white for Christmas Day, as it represents Mary, the mother of Jesus. Gracious God, you came to us in human flesh through the Blessed Mother Mary, and you abide with us in the Holy Spirit. Fill us with your joy, and help us shine as a light to the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We speak of hope because God keeps his promises to us. We work for peace because Jesus is the Prince of Peace and he calls his children to work for peace in his name. We show love because Jesus gave everything for us and led us to know the forgiveness of God. We share joy because the Holy Spirit fills our hearts and minds with the presence of God. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now, joining with the millions of other Christians all over the world today, who, as we saw last week, say these words in their own language, we bring all our prayers together in the words that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing this service with us, and we hope you can be with us again next week. And now, a closing prayer of blessing. May the love of the Father, the tenderness of the Son, and the presence of the Spirit gladden our hearts and bring peace to our souls, this day and all our days. Amen.